Rochester Institute of Technology, you say RIT. You may have heard of MIT, similar institute, you know, but we're not so famous. Within the university, so my university is RIT, I'm in my department is the Center for Imaging Science, and the name there is the Chester F. Carlson Center. Chester F. Carlson was the man that invented the Xerox process, and so that business began in Rochester, New York. Rochester, New York was also the home of Kodak, the film company, which is now out of business because of we don't use film anymore, now we use digital cameras. But of course, as digital cameras came into being, the Center for Imaging Science found an area for research. So the Center for Imaging Science is a very multidisciplinary center, all aspects of imaging. Remote sensing is one of those aspects. I have colleagues that do work with medical imaging. I have colleagues that work with building new types of detectors, digital detectors. I have colleagues that work with human vision, colleagues that work with understanding color science, how we perceive color, and so on. Very multidisciplinary center. The largest research group. So the largest research group in the center is the remote sensing group. So the digital imaging and remote sensing focuses very much on airborne and satellite imaging of the Earth and targets on the Earth. Many of my colleagues work in remote sensing, work with defense and intelligence applications of remote sensing. And myself, I focus more on environmental aspects of remote sensing. But the nice thing about having this people working on different topics is that there's a lot of interaction between an understanding of advanced technologies that come from that. So there's a little bit of an introduction. And so to start, I need the video. So you're probably all familiar with this now.
They are going to be.
And of course, this drone right here, there's a camera. There's a camera attached to the drone. And, you know, the drone is actually it's taking off on a pre-programmed flight path. So it goes and it will fly a particular pre-programmed path according to the GPS position, the GPS on the drone. And so, of course, that's a new topic area that is very much coming forward, as you say. And we're working in that area as well. This is some work that we're starting to do with my colleagues. So we'll touch on that. And then here's our laboratory group. So, and these are the faculty members, both what we call tenure track faculty members as well as research faculty. So I just currently became the director of the laboratory because the former director is now the director of the center. And these are my colleagues, and in particular, John Schott is the person who created the laboratory and is now retired or semi-retired. The active faculty member, Jan Benard, is from South Africa. He joined us a few years ago. Emmett Mutalucci is a research scientist. John Karakas works with hyperspectral imaging image processing. Bob Hemmons works primarily in wildland fire processing. Dave Messenger imaging again. Harvey Rohde is retired, is an excellent teacher and electrical engineering background, image processing. Carl Servaggio is the one who is doing the drone work right now. And in particular, if you're very interested in remote sensing, John Schott is the author of this particular textbook, which is probably the best advanced textbook for remote sensing, and certainly one of the best that is definitely at the advanced level. And we are currently have an open faculty position. So we are searching for a new faculty member because, again, Dave Messenger became the director, so now he's no longer, we have an open slot for a faculty member to join our group. So in outline, what I want to talk about, just some basic things about imaging systems, because maybe, of course, we all look at images every day, but maybe you haven't had some background in what are things we need to be concerned about if we want to use images for doing science or engineering. So some trade-offs in that, a little bit about the physics of what it means for us to create a remote sensing image. The methodologies, what are some of the ways that we need to process the image before it becomes data? Before we do some types of processing, it's just a picture that somebody can look at, but how do you turn that into data that you can extract information from in science? So we take some measurements on the ground, and I'll show a little bit about that, and then satellite data. Think about working with satellite data versus working with unmanned aerial systems. The images look very different. There are different problems that need to be solved. So this is a very active area of research because, particularly with unmanned aerial systems and then very high resolution satellite data that is now available, it leads to new imaging problems. How do we extract information from images? And I'll show a few application areas in agriculture, looking at harmful algal blooms in lakes, and a vehicle tracking application. So what is remote sensing? Non-contact measurement or learning from a distance. This is what I was taught. So if you think of how we do remote sensing, we all do remote sensing with our eyes. Our vision is a remote sensing methodology. It's just not, it's built into us. And of course, just a simple camera, a digital camera, is also remote sensing. And then we put cameras on satellites. They're all really remote sensing. It's how we learn about what's in the world using an imaging technique. When you think about imaging systems, you have to consider the resolution of the system. And there are basically four different types of resolution you have to consider. First of all is the bit depth. How is the information that's in the image within a single pixel, how is that recorded? How many bits are used to store the data on a computer? So if it's a one-bit image, like this one on the left, it's only black and white. And as we add more bits, we have more levels of gray value in between. And as we keep going, the image gets better and better. It's the same image. It's just how much information is stored in those bits. So that's one thing we have to consider. The other thing we have to consider is how many pixels. You're all probably very familiar with this. Our digital cameras have more and more pixels, and you get a better and better image with your resolution. The other part we usually don't think about, or many people don't think about, is what part of the spectrum are we going to look in? With a consumer camera, on a phone or whatever, you only have to consider the visible part of the spectrum. But of course, with remote sensing, we might want to use a thermal camera if we want to understand the temperature of a system, or we use radio wavelengths in radar applications. We have to consider what part of the spectrum. And then, within that part of the spectrum, how many measurements do we make? And so let me focus on the visible spectrum here. If we have just a consumer camera, we are actually making three color measurements, red, green, and blue. That gives us our color. But in many science applications, we want more than that. Either multispectral, where we may have many more, more than three. And then finally, essentially a spectroscopic measurement, where we're making very fine measurements across the entire spectrum. We have to consider what part of the spectrum and how we are going to measure that. It depends upon our application area. What do we want to to do with the image. And then the last one I want to touch on is how frequently do we collect images? Is it, do we have a system like on, if it's a satellite system, something like Meteosat, it's looking at the entire globe, it collects an image of the entire globe in about 15 minutes. If we have an orbiting satellite, like one of the commercial satellites from, well, actually, you know, many countries now have, does Turkey have a satellite, imaging satellite? Yeah, okay. It's in an orbit, it collects images at some as the satellite comes back. And so you have to worry about how frequently that image is collected. And of course, now with unmanned aerial systems, it's an on-demand sensing. You go there and you collect the image when you want to. And in particular, I think the huge advantage of unmanned aerial systems, of course, is there's two. One is the cost. So satellite systems are extremely expensive. Just to launch a satellite costs about $250 million. You know, a big satellite, depends on one satellite. And then you have, of course, the system. You have to build a system that's not going to break. It has to work. Of course, unmanned aerial systems are becoming very cheap, very inexpensive. The other aspect of an unmanned aerial system, it's very low altitude, and it can fly under the clouds. If you have a satellite system, and it's cloudy, and your system is looking in the thermal or the visible air part of the spectrum, you do not see the ground. So there are many parts. One place that I work in quite a bit is in Africa, in Central Africa, tropical region. It's very frequently cloudy. It's very difficult to get satellite images. It's very infrequently that I can collect an image. It's a problem. And unmanned aerial systems could be an answer to that, as well as aircraft. Of course, aircraft, unmanned aircraft, are going to cost more than an unmanned aerial system. Okay, so then this is what we need to consider. Here's the physics. This is where the radiation is going. When we want to consider what we want to see, our target is basically what's on the ground. We have a target here. This is two examples, here and here. And we have reflected sunlight, or in the emissive, this would be, for example, thermal, so temperature emitted by the object. And L is the radiance, or you could think the digital counts that reach the sensor. Where does that come from? And what you see here, there are four different pathways that radiation takes from the sun to the target. And the one that we're interested in is A, directly to the target and directly to the sensor. That's what we're interested in. Everything else gets in the way. It's a problem. Potentially. And the same thing with emissive. What we are interested in is the target, its temperature, ray G, to the sensor. That's what we're interested in. That relates to the temperature of the object. Everything else gets in the way. So we spend in quantitative remote sensing, trying to extract information from images, from aircraft, or from space. You have to be very concerned about what the atmosphere is doing to the scene, because much of the signal can be from the atmosphere and not from the target on the ground. So there's a great deal of research that has to go into being very concerned about that. So these terms, the piece that we're interested in is this first term right here. That's the piece we're interested in. And we're also interested in this. So the first term here is path A. The second term right there is path G, and these other pieces are the other paths in there. So from here on, this all has to be removed before we get to the signal that we're interested in. This also tells you, this description, these rays, shows you a way that you can model the process. So you can create models of what you expect to see by somehow, you know, mathematically, computationally, creating each of these pathways and doing the physics to say, well, what would my image look like if I added them all up? If I created all these pieces in a computer, I'll get a basically synthetically model what I expect to see. And so that's actually a very important component of the research that's done in my group. We have essentially a computer model that will generate synthetic remote sensing scenes, all aspects of a scene. So if you imagine, if you take an image from a satellite, we can mathematically model the image, the entire image. What does that look like, including the spectral processes and the thermal processes? What would that image look like? And so how do you do that? So to do that, you have to build what's called a wireframe model, or a facetized model, so a three-dimensional structure of the Earth. And this is just an example showing that. So you need that piece. And you need, then, to each facet of that three-dimensional model, you have to assign a property. How does it reflect light, and how does it emit light? That's the physics part. And you notice that these have, and then you have to build a sensor. What are the characteristics of the sensor that would observe that scene? And then you have to decide, when I had those rays, how many rays do you send to a facet? How many times do you do the computation? The more times you do the computation, the more accurate your result will be. And that's shown right here. So if I send only one ray to the facet, I get this type of result. If I add three rays, I get a better result. And finally, if I do 10 times, I get even a better result. Of course, that means I have to use the computer. It's 10 times longer. I have to do 10 times as many computations. Yes, question?
Yeah. Are you sending those rays after one another, or all together?
That's I think a matter of a Monte Carlo method would be essentially one after another.
Yeah.
So you just do millions of computations. Mm-hmm. Or a parallel. If you're a good computer scientist and you can do a parallel method, then you can do many at the same time. So these types of computations, it depends upon the complexity of the scene. But we can generate scenes sometimes in a few minutes.
If it's moving, you know, so I think it is better to get a parallel one. If it is moving, the object, right?
That's
maybe it is better to set the rays parallel.
Right. So. That's a matter of computation. That's a problem for a computer scientist. Yes, I agree, absolutely. And that is a problem. It takes time to do these images. But it doesn't cost millions of dollars. So we can, you know, in fact, one of the recent research projects simulated one of the American satellite systems called Landsat. Did simulations of the new sensor before it was launched, and that allowed NASA to do processing on images. They were not real images, they were synthetic images, but they were complete. They were as if they were collected by the system. So it's an important topic. And so that program is really one of the most important pieces of work that's done in my research laboratory. That computer program is pretty unique and quite advanced in what it's capable of doing. This is a synthetic image that was created by that. So on the right, this is from Google Maps. This is a satellite view of this piece of Rochester, New York. And this is a computer-generated version of that. Again, this has three-dimensional structure, the trees, the buildings. And it has the spectral properties of vegetation, of the building materials, of the road materials. So it looks like it was collected by a sensor from space. Right? Here's an example of that. It's the same area, more or less. And what this is showing is, imagine that you were in an airplane, maybe, looking down at the ground. You know, depending upon where the sun is, you see the effect of the atmosphere. Sometimes it's hazy, and it depends on where the angle is. So that's what this is. The way that this is, if the sun is in the morning, and there's a rather hazy atmosphere, even like today here in Izmir, it's hazy. it affects what you can see. And so what this is the effect of the atmosphere. Of course, this is synthetic, so we can separate these out. This is what the scene would look like. This is what the atmosphere itself is, that component of the scene, and which is what's coming from the path radiant. This is an image of the atmospheric transmission. And this is showing where the sun is located. So as I do, as I flip from one slide to the next, you'll see the sun changes position and the scene looks different just because of the atmosphere. So here we go. So it says, if it went through the day, how would that scene change? And it also includes, if you look closely on the image here, that the shadows are included. At the beginning, the sun is in this direction. At the end of the day, the sun is in this direction. Let me go backwards. So the shadows change. And that's all generated by the computer system, right? By the model. All right, so I think you can see maybe why having this capability would be really important. And again, you think of many, many applications of this. We do a lot of our scientific work thinking about how do systems work, how do we get information from images with these synthetic images. Because it's much less expensive than going out and collecting real images from an airplane, for example. The other problem, of course, is we can create many scenes without repeatedly collecting real images. Okay, so this is then, okay, we're done with the physics. Now we're thinking about what do we do with the images? How do we get the information out of the images that we want? So I was trained, my initial training in remote sensing was how to extract information from images visually by looking at them. So there's a very distinct process. These nine aspects of an image are how you learn about these, this is how you extract information and decide what is in the scene. So by looking, and for me to think about size, shape, colors, patterns, all of these things, I can look at this image and I can tell you what's there. Right? So that's what a human interpreter does. And there's a pattern to that. You can be taught that through learning these examples. So can anybody tell me what this is? It's from an aerial scene looking down, like it was from an airplane.
It's kind of purple.
Yeah, there's a river here, right? And what's this here?
Agriculture.
Hmm? Agriculture areas? Yeah, agriculture areas. You see agriculture here. And this is where the river used to flow.
Right.
This is on a floodplain. And so you see the pattern of where the river has moved over time. Right? And it's very flat. And so there's agriculture there. Because it's a floodplain. It's flat. And so you can interpret that from this image. You understand quite a bit about the scene from the image. Now you learn something about the geomorphology of the location by doing that interpretation. Okay. But what we spend much of our time now doing is understanding the spectral aspects. What is the visible and infrared and thermal processes that produce those spectral measurements? When I talked about the system, you want to measure the spectrum. And this is one example. For example, vegetation. Why does vegetation look the way it does? Why does it look green? Because chlorophyll. chlorophyll absorbs, light is coming in of all colors, and a red light is absorbed by the chlorophyll, and the blue light is absorbed by the chlorophyll, which allows the green light to be reflected, and so we see vegetation as being green. Well, our eye does not see infrared radiation, near infrared. However, that radiation is also reflected.